Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and this is going to be part two of our introduction to organic chemistry. Now in organic, one of the big things that we're going to be looking at in this particular class or any course on organic chemistry is the story of functional groups. Now what are they exactly? Well, these are special substituents or branches that are attached to our parent chain. And the whole idea with these is that they really define the properties and behaviors of the molecules, and they define all the different types of reactions that they are capable of partaking in as we are going to see them. So let's take a look at all of our different functional groups and try to understand a little bit about them and what they look like, so that way you can start memorizing them for your organic chemistry class. And so that way when you do labs and are learning about them, they'll make a little bit more sense as you go forward. Before we continue on to our functional groups, we must go over some common abbreviations that you are going to be seeing in the next part of this video or throughout an organic chemistry class. The first one is the letter R, which is commonly placed on different structures or functional groups. And all that means is it represents the rest of the molecule. So for example, if I have a molecule that looks like this and I say RX. Well, what exactly does that mean? Well, R is generally, like I said, the rest of the molecule, which could be something as simple as, let's say, it could be an alkyl chain. Like, for example, we have a butane here with an X group. It could be any type of chain. Now, what about X? Well, X is a halogen. It's something that comes from introductory chemistry. We commonly will use an X just to say it could be fluorine, bromine, chlorine, iodine. It doesn't exactly matter in that situation, but it is a halogen, which is a reactive chemical. So this is something, if you do see them, it's just referring to it's a larger molecule. Let's go on to our functional groups. This first one is alkenes. Alkenes we went over in part one. This is anything that is involving a double bonded structure. So if we have C with a double bond, and that is connected to, let's say, hydrogens, or even if it's connected to another chain, it has that double bonded structure, which is the key thing that we are looking for in any of those types of examples. Another type of example of a structural formula with this is, let's say I have my rest of my molecule. It has that CC double bond within the structure, and we want to show that it has other key little traits with it as well. So the whole entire thing that we are looking for as we are trying to represent these structures is that we have that double bonded structure. On to our next. Our next group is the alkynes. Alkynes are what have a triple bonded structure. So we're looking for that C triple bond C. And a different example of this is, let's say if I have a very long chain, if it's going like CH3, CH2, and then all of a sudden I have C with a triple bond in the middle of the structure. This is representing an alkyne just like this. You could also represent that as a geometric shape as well, just like so, where you have the same exact structure behind that. Let's make sure this is correct. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. As you can see, I'm counting my carbons as I am drawing all those little pieces. So that is a big important part of as you're going through the chemistry is counting carbons. Our next one is an alkyl halide, which as you can see from this one, we are using that R group as well as that X for a halide or halogen. So this just means that we have a alkyl chain attached to either chlorine or bromine or iodine. So for example, if I just draw a propane here, with a chlorine on it, we have chloropropane. This would be an example. If we are to draw another type of chain where, let's say, I have a bromine attached, that would be another example. You might also just commonly see an X telling you that you have a halogen on it. There are many different types of examples. Alcohols are a common functional group that we see in our everyday lives, whether it's at maybe out on a weekend or it's in the kitchen. We commonly see alcohols all around us. Alcohols are always denoted by the OH group that is on that, which is your hydroxyl group. So this denotes that we have an alcohol. So like I mentioned, hydroxyl, telling you you have that OH attachment on it or an alcohol. With this one, it's the same idea as before. If I have a chain with an OH on it, or potentially a ring structure with an OH on it, that's letting you know we have an alcohol structure. Our next functional group is an ether. The thing about an ether is that you notice that there's an oxygen holding hands with a different functional group on both sides. So with this, it doesn't have to necessarily be the same exact alkyl group. You'll commonly notice that someone will draw all maybe an R with an apostrophe next to it. That's letting you know that the chains do not have to match. So if you see R prime or R double prime, triple prime, this is telling you that all the groups are different as they are being shown. So ether is always joining two pieces together. So if I were to draw an example of this, this could be like this one here where we have dimethyl ether, or we could try to expand that. Let's say if I made it where we have our geometric structures, and we could see that, okay, both of them are not the same. We have one that has two carbons on it, and then the other one over on the far side has three carbons on it. So each one of them is different. Thiols are a major part of more into biochemistry. We do see them in organic. They're responsible for a lot of aromas, generally stuff that is very pungent. So thiols are the one type of molecule you'll see with a sulfur atom on it. They also bond to two things, just like oxygen, being that they're part of the same group right below each other. So with these, typically you will see just a little sulfur attached to the side of a chain, just like before. They do not necessarily have to only be at that first position, but they could also be at the second one as well. And these are your thiols. With ketones, these are your first species that have a carbon double bonded to an oxygen. Oxygen needs two bonds. Notice how we have a double bond here. What that does is it fulfills its requirement of needing those two bonds. So you either see oxygen in the form bonding in the form of an alcohol or a double bonded O. There are many different structures that do contain that double bonded oxygen shape. Typically, you will always see that C double bond O written like right like so, where all of a sudden you have that vertical point right in the middle where it's showing a carbon. You might also see them on ring structures or on cyclic compounds too. They don't always necessarily need to be in one way, but ketones are always in the middle of a chain. So keep that in mind. It looks more like it's the key to unlocking the whole chain. It has to be in the middle of the chain. Our next example is an aldehyde. Notice how this looks very similar to a ketone. The previous example showed that when we had a ketone, it looked like this, where we had a C double bonded O with an R group on both sides. Now, the difference between the ketone and the aldehyde is all lies on that hydrogen that is connected at neck to our carbon. So we got to pay attention that if you see a hydrogen attached, this has to be on the end of a chain. It has several different properties, and its reactivity changes when you have that hydrogen located only at the end. So if we were to show some of these different structures, generally we have that C double bond O written right at the end of a structure, or it's as an offshoot or a branch on a cyclic compound as well. With carboxylic acids, what sets this apart is that now we have two different functional groups attached to the same carbon. So notice how you have that C double bonded O, also the OH. So whenever we have these C double bonded oxygens that are here, it's something that when you have them attached to a structure, make sure you look on both sides of the carbon to see what is attached to it. As I will commonly say throughout these videos, as you're crossing the street, and as if the C double bond O is your street, you want to look both ways. In this case, you see that OH that is attached here. This is your acidic property. So if you think of lemons or oranges or anything that is acidic in a lot of our foods, this is what is responsible for those. So for a common example of this is, let's say if I do CH3, C double bond O with an OH, this is acetic acid, so or also known as vinegar. This is also something that has to be on the end of a chain. Next functional group is esters. Esters, all as you can see here, have that C double bond O and also have an oxygen next to them as well, but it's being linked by a rest of the molecule R on both sides. So it does not, once again, does not have to be the exact same thing, but there's going to be an alkyl chain on both sides of the molecule. So let's say if I have this structure here with that O with another O here, this is an example of an ester. Now, esters are something that you're going to smell. They're typically found in perfumes, colognes, fruits, for example, flowers. They're responsible for a lot of aromas that you will commonly come across in everyday life. The next one, these are referred to as amines. Amine, the way to think about this is think of the word minimum, meaning that we have the minimum number of attachments on it, compared to the next one, which is going to be amides, which have that C double bonded O. With amines, the big thing is nitrogen, if you can remember, can form up to three bonds. So on this, you can see that we have our first example of an amine, which is typically very commonly written as R, NH2 as R group. Now, depending on the type of amine, this is referred to as a primary amine, where it's only attached to one R group. The other ones, you can see it's attached to two R groups, and then three R groups is the other types. So we have primary, secondary, tertiary, which we will cover in other videos as well, which is all about how many different carbons can they possibly be attached to. Now, our next example, which is amides, they look a lot different than before. Amides, you can see, have that C double bonded oxygen here, right? So it's crossing that street and looking both sides before crossing. We can see that we add another piece to it, making it a lot more complicated than an amine, right? Amine, as I mentioned, has the minimum number of pieces, is how we can remember that, where it only has that one single R group that is attached to it, compared to an amide has a double bonded oxygen. So to show some examples of both amines and amides, it's the same general idea that if we want to show that structure, we can show our amine here, and it can also attach just very similar to an ester. When it comes to amines, this is when we have our NH2 attached at the end. It could be in the middle of a chain. It could link things together because it can make those three bonds around the nitrogen. That's very different. Amines and amides tend to be very, amines are very smelly compounds. They typically smell like fish. Amides are actually one of the leading bonds that you'll find in protein chains behind peptides. So they're a very important part into biochemistry and understanding biological function. Our last functional group is a phenyl group, or also known as an aromatic ring. So with an aromatic ring, you can notice that it has three alternating double bonds within the structure, which I'm highlighting here in blue. This is also very commonly known as a benzene ring. So if we ever see that compound where we have the benzene ring here, that is a very specific and special shape that we will talk about in future videos of how aromatics are extremely stable groups. Benzenes are commonly used in pharmaceutical compounds to help stabilize a structure so that way it is able to actually help your body and to survive a long time to deliver its effects in the body. So let's now go through some common examples that you will see in your organic chemistry course. It's very common that you will have to identify different functional groups within compounds. So if we have the following molecule here, and I ask you, okay, let's go through trying to identify the different functional groups. And you can see there are many. The first one that if we can quickly notice is that right over here. So we have an ether compound. We also have some others as well. If we have the one over here, we notice that we have an alcohol. And then as we kind of go through this compound as well, we can see that we have some others. We have over here, you have that C double bonded O, which if you kind of go through your notes and look, you're trying to think like, oh, which one is it? Because remember, it's all about crossing the street before you go across. With this one, it is a very common error that students will make. This one is an aldehyde. With this, like, what do I mean by a common error? Well, being that we see it's on the side of the chain, we can remember that we can fill in a hydrogen here. Remember, four bonds for every one of these carbons that we have. So let's say if I highlight the carbon here in green, and we can zoom in on that. Well, we can count the number of bonds, right? We have 1, 2, 3, 4 bonds all around that structure. So there's a hydrogen there. So that is an aldehyde. Now, what else is there in the structure? There might be one other. You might see your big aromatic group as well, which is the ring structure here. So that is your phenyl group, which is a part of your ring as well. So those are all the different types. Let's go into another common mistake and problem that students make for identifying their functional groups, which is so important for your organic course. Okay, this example, once again, identify the functional groups. Now with these, what a lot of students do is they make common mistakes with identified groups that they see right away. Make sure you look at everything connected to it because it could be a slightly different example. So for example, right here, I see that, I have an alcohol group that is attached to this ring. We have an OH, which makes perfect sense. However, one thing that you can quickly notice is that there is a C double bond O that is right next to it. We have to look at the entire structure all around because this is a much larger group here. This is a carboxylic acid. Whenever we have C double bonded O's, look on both sides of the street before crossing, right? So when we have that carbon, we're going to look to the left, look to the right, see if there's anything near it. And you should do this for all functional groups because it could have an altered identity because of that. So that is a carboxylic acid. What else do we have? Over here, we see an NH2, right? So that is something different. Now the question, is it amine or is it an amide? Amine is the minimum configuration. So we only see an NH2 connect to the rest of the chain. So this is an amine group. Our next portion over on the far side, we have this over here, which is referring to an alcohol, right? And then we also, once again, have our benzene structure. So we highlight the ring here, we can see that we have a benzene or an aromatic, also known as a phenyl group. And that is our last part. So we have all those little pieces. Let's try another, which you're more than welcome to pause the video and try yourself and see if you can try to identify all the functional groups on this compound. Now, when we look at this, the first thing I notice is this C double bond O that is right here on the side of the structure. Now, the thing with the C double bonded O is trying to figure out exactly which one is it. Now, this we can see that, well, we're missing one bond here and it has a hydrogen there. So remember, we always count to 4, right? How do I see the 4? Well, we have our hydrogen here. We have the single bonded carbon to carbon bond. And then we have one part of the double bond, the second part of the double bond, right? Those 4 colors all represent the 4 bonds that are here in this particular group. So this is what is representing an aldehyde, right? So that is our group here. So let's label that. Now, what other groups do I have? Well, I also have another group that looks very similar to that. I have a C double bonded over here, but this is an example of a ketone that is on the other side of the structure. And then the last group is an alcohol. Now, the last thing is what a common mistake is this a phenyl group? There's a ring here. However, it's missing a key piece like the one above. The one above had those alternating double bonds. This doesn't exist here. So this is just a normal ring or cyclic compound versus the acyclic that we talked about in part one, which is just a chain. So there's different types of chains and organic hydrocarbons that we are going to see. So this is the end of our second part of just setting that language. There will be many videos to come for Chem 3 for these types of introductory organic and biochemistry videos to help our allied health sciences better master this course and all your courses that you are taking out there in the internet world. This has been Dr. Dan. I hope this video helped. And please hit that like and subscribe button to see future videos out there. All right, I'll see you all later. Bye now.